John Wayne Gacy. Norwood Park is neither part of the city of Chicago nor part of the city of Des Plaines. The city police departments of the two conurbations have no jurisdiction over crimes committed there and have to leave them to the county sheriff's department. In December 1978, the citizens of Norwood were not a little surprised to find the Des Plaines police staking out 8213 West Summerdale Avenue, home of nice Mr. Gacy, the fat and friendly building contractor who'd lived there for 7 years. The watch began on December the 13th, after a muddy and dishevelled Gacy had been less than willing to comply with a request that he go and be interviewed by detectives at Des Plaines Police Headquarters. The interview was unsatisfactory from the police point of view, and the decision was taken to put a tail on Gacy and to keep a close watch on his house. On December the 19th, Gacy invited the two officers keeping watch to have breakfast with him. What they smelt on entering the house gave them grounds to ask for a search warrant. Police flocked to the house, and astonished neighbours watched as a stream of bodies was carried out. First one, then another, finally seven from a crawl space to the front of the house. Another eight were found covered with quicklime in a subterranean trench. By the time the house and garden had been fully excavated, 28 corpses had been brought to light. The puzzling comment Gacy had made to neighbours about the house in which he lived alone becoming too crowded for him now made perfect sense. John Wayne Gacy was born in 1942. He suffered a severe accident when he was 11. A swing struck him on the head, following which he suffered blackouts and headaches. When he was 16, a blood clot on the brain was diagnosed, but this was dissolved by medication and the blackout ceased. Then he was discovered to have a heart condition. Gacy overcame these problems, though, and went to business college. On graduating, he became a shoe salesman and married a colleague in the business. His father-in-law set him up managing a fried chicken fast food business in Waterloo, Iowa. Gacy was a popular and successful local businessman. He worked hard. He liked to be liked. He and his wife had a son and a daughter. It seemed a tragedy to all who knew him when his world fell apart in 1968. He had to give up the fried chicken business. His wife divorced him. And in 1971, Gacy returned to his birthplace, Chicago, to start over again. He set up as a building contractor. It was at this time that Gacy bought the house at 8213 West Summerdale Avenue. Soon he met up with an old flame, Carol Hoff, and they married on June the 1st, 1972. This marriage, too, only lasted 4 years. But this time, Gacy's position in the community seemed assured. He became a member of the Junior Chamber of Commerce. He was also active in the Democratic Party and had cards printed to mark his rise to the organizing position of precinct captain. He made donations to charity and to the party and was photographed shaking hands with Michael Bilandic, Chicago's mayor. Among his most attractive activities were the charity entertainments he put on for children. As Pogo the Clown, in white face and ruffled costume, he would do conjuring tricks and hand out balloons at parties or in children's wards in hospitals. The mother of one of the boys, whose body came out from Gacy's house in later years, recalled, "He was a very nice man to work for, and he liked the kids. And my son told me he was a politician. He says, 'Boy, if you stick with that guy, you could go far. He's got a lot of connections.'" The high point of Gacy's public life came after he'd organised three fundraising events for President Jimmy Carter's re-election campaign. As a loyal Democrat, he was introduced to First Lady Rosalynn Carter when she came to Chicago, and to her subsequent embarrassment, he was even photographed with her. The dark side of Gacy's life went back a long way. His father was of Polish extraction. His mother was Danish. His childhood was not happy. His father drank and beat him, and at least one of the family's friends abused him sexually. Those who knew him best when he achieved success in business were aware of him as a braggart who tried to buy popularity with gifts. The collapse of his marriage in 1968 came after attempts to seduce young men who worked for him in the fried chicken business, handcuffing them in the back room and offering them money for sex. One potential victim objected strongly and refused Gacy's request that he practice fellatio on him. When Gaty attempted to sodomise him, the lad escaped and went straight to the police. It became apparent that the boy was going to press charges, so Gacy hired thugs to beat him up. It made a nasty little story in court, and Judge Peter Van Meter had no hesitation in handing down a 10-year sentence. However, 26-year-old Gacy's ingratiating skills came into play at once. He was a first offender. He became a model prisoner and resolutely eschewed all homosexual advances made to him in prison. In this way, he won parole after serving a mere 18 months. Gacy's attempt to go straight in Chicago was not very long-lived. In the year he arrived there, he was arrested for picking up a teenage boy and trying to force him to have sex. The case was discharged when the adolescent plaintiff failed to appear in court. A young man who went to West Summerdale Avenue looking for work as a building labourer later revealed that Gacy pulled a gun on him, trying to force him to engage in sexual activity. The fat contractor snarled, "I killed a guy before." The young worker did not believe him. Gacy was probably telling the truth, although on this occasion the threat of violence did not become reality. When he married Carole, friends who came to his home for the reception noticed an odd smell. Gacy explained that water was leaking into the crawl space. Well before the marriage broke down, Gacy was cruising gay areas of Chicago and showing sexual interest in good-looking young employees. Two of them, John Butkovich and Greg Grodzik, disappeared. A detective, hired by Greg's mother, was unable to trace him. At home, Gacy became increasingly violent. He beat up Carole until she left him in 1976, and within a year he'd come to police attention again. A boy complained that Gacy had taken him to Norwood Park, held him at gunpoint, and subjected him to brutal sexual abuse. Gacy admitted the use of a gun and the ferocious sex, but claimed that the boy was a willing masochistic partner who was now trying to blackmail him. The gun had been nothing more than an exciting sexual prop. Chicago police kept a half-hearted eye on him for 30 days, but nothing more untoward turned up and the matter was dropped. The following year, Gacy made a pickup who refused to cooperate with him. On March the 21st, Gacy met 27-year-old Jeffrey Rignall on North Broadway in Newtown, Chicago, and invited him to join him in his sleek black Oldsmobile for a drive and a joint. Rignall agreed, but within minutes of his entering the car, Gacy pulled over to the curb and slapped a chloroform-soaked rag over his passenger's face. Rignall eventually came round sufficiently to be aware that the car, which was travelling very fast, had pulled off a motorway exit. The next thing he knew, he was naked and tied into a sort of pillory or rack in Gacy's basement. Gacy was naked too, his gross, hairy belly protruding obscenely. The fat man gloated over his victim, showing him various whips and promising to use them on him. He kept his promise. For hours he tortured and sodomised Jeffrey Rignall. From time to time he slapped the chloroform over his face to quieten him, and then waited for him to regain consciousness before whipping and raping him again. "There was no hope of escape," he told Rignall, claiming to be a policeman. "I'd just as soon shoot you as look at you," he sneered. The sexual assaults were so painful that Rignall wanted to die, but when he begged Gacy to release him, promising to leave town and say nothing about the incident, he was surprisingly granted his freedom. Gacy then chloroformed him once again. When Rignall came round, he was fully clothed under a statue in Lincoln Park, Chicago. His wallet and money were untouched, but his driving license was missing. He was bleeding from the rectum, his face was burned by the repeated applications of chloroform, and hospital tests showed that the heavy doses of the drug Gacy administered had permanently damaged his liver. But at least he was alive and free. Jeffrey Rignall went to the police. The Chicago Police Department's lackadaisical attitude to his complaint astounded and enraged him. Since he did not know his assailant's name or car number and could not give them an address, they told him there was little they could do. They held out no hope of the fat sadist ever being caught and evidently had no intention of trying to track him down. So Jeffrey Rignall did it himself. He hired a car and took it along the route he vaguely recollected travelling in the Oldsmobile. Gacy's car was a very distinctive vehicle, and when Rignall came to the expressway exit he thought he remembered his torturer taking, he parked beside it and watched the traffic for hours. During one of his vigils, he spotted Gacy's car leaving the highway. Rignall tailed the Oldsmobile to West Summerdale Avenue and noted the house number 8213. He had some knowledge of real estate documentation, as he had once worked for a law firm. Through land records, he found Gacy's name and triumphantly went to Chicago Police Department with the information, at the same time offering himself as a positive identification witness against Gacy. To his astonishment, Chicago's finest were still loath to take serious action against this monster. They told Rignall that the man he named had been convicted of sodomy in Iowa and sent to prison, but they did not act. It's not clear whether they thought Rignall was a cannabis-smoking pervert who'd willingly got into a strange man's car and deserved all he got, or more sinister still, whether a glad-handing contributor to the mayor's various political funds and chosen charities was being given a free hand to beat and sexually abuse strangers if that was his pleasure. Rignall had to press the Chicago police to issue an arrest warrant. When the cops finally met with Rignall at Norwood Park, they suddenly announced that there would be no arrest. Norwood Park was out of their jurisdiction, and he would have to start all over again with the county sheriff's department. Rignall did no such thing. He and his lawyer, Fred Richman, had Gacy arrested on a misdemeanor charge of battery and proceeded to open a civil suit against him. Chicago police still would not issue the felony indictment that was obviously called for, and as he had done the year before, Gacy tried to turn the tables on his accuser. He countersued Rignall. Things were getting too hot for comfort by the middle of 1978, however, and in the end he settled Rignall's $3,000 medical bills out of court. The real pressure started soon after 9 p.m. on December the 11th, 1978, when Mrs. Elizabeth Peast of Des Plaines went down to the Nissen Pharmacy to fetch her 15-year-old son Robert back for her birthday party. Robert asked her to let him go and talk to a contractor living nearby about a vacation job first. "I'll be right back," he promised, but he wasn't. After half an hour, Mr. and Mrs. Peast and their son and daughter, Ken and Kerry, went looking for Robert. When they couldn't find him and went to Des Plaines police, their reception contrasted wonderfully with Chicago's suspicious bearishness in the Rignall case. Police Captain Joseph Cottonjack was sure that this was not the sort of family nor Robert the sort of boy to give rise to a runaway escapade. Convinced there had been foul play, he put Des Plaines youth officer Ron Adams on the case. Adams found out from the drugstore that Gacy was most likely the contractor Peast had gone to visit. He telephoned Gacy at 9:30 a.m. on December the 12th and was rudely brushed off. "I don't talk to any kids. I can't help you. I don't know anything about it," was all Pogo the clown would say. Captain Kozenchak was far from satisfied. He learned about Gacy's Iowa sodomy conviction and became more than ever convinced that the man knew something about Robert Peast's disappearance. He took some colleagues to Norwood Park to interview the suspect, but got nothing helpful out of Gacy, just vague mutterings about talking to one of the boys about some shelves discarded from the revamped Nissen Pharmacy. When Kozenchak asked him to come down to the station to make a formal statement, Gacy dragged out an opportune phone call about an uncle who'd just died for as long as he could manage. The police waited politely and insisted that they wanted him to come with them. But he burst out, "Hey, I got a lot of important work to do. I can't be coming down to the police station. I know this kid's missing, but that's not important to me." Kozenchak was absolutely furious. "Well, it is important to the parents," he snapped. But he was helpless. Without evidence to bring charges, he had no option but to let Gacy go. From then on, he determined that Gacy should feel the real heat of constant observation. Unfortunately, on the first day, Gacy managed to give his tail the slip. He'd been out to his car during the night and put something he wanted to dispose of in the boot. When he saw watchers outside the house, he leaped in the car and roared away to a racing start that left them standing. His journey took him to Interstate Highway 55 and the Des Plaines River. Clearly, it was in some way upsetting, for his car went mysteriously out of control on the way back and had to be towed out of a ditch. It was a muddy, confused, and glassy-eyed Gacy who presented himself at Des Plaines Police Headquarters to make a voluntary statement. The statement was not very helpful, though. Still, Captain Kozenchek and Assistant State Attorney Terry Sullivan succeeded in persuading a judge to issue a search warrant, even though there was little more than suspicion against Gacy. The search of 8213 West Summerdale Avenue turned up only a sales slip from the Nissen Pharmacy. This would, in the end, be invaluable evidence, for it had been made out to Robert Peast and proved that he'd been in Gacy's house. The significance of the slip was not evident at first, and Gacy's attitude to the persistent police tale became patronising as the conviction grew that he'd well and truly beaten the cops. Hence his swaggering gesture of offering breakfast to the two officers on duty on December the 19th. When they remarked on the smell in the house, Gacy casually said that he'd disconnected his drain sump pump and water had got into the crawl space. That was the clue the officers needed. In no time, the department had a new search warrant, and policemen were back to examine the crawl space that had been overlooked before. Then, one by one, the bodies were uncovered. They were in no condition to be identified. Some had been there since 1975 and were completely skeletal. It was impossible to tell how each had died. But the exposure of the cache was too much for Gacy. Before long, he was confessing and explaining why Robert Peast's body had not yet been uncovered. Gacy had been picking up and killing boys and young men, torturing and raping them over the previous 3 years at least. Some were employees, some were offered jobs, some were male prostitutes. Gacy would invite them to his home and use his expertise as Pogo the Clown to show them some conjuring tricks. Eventually would come a trick which involved handcuffing the spectator. With his victim now helpless, Gacy put a rope round his neck and took him to the basement for sadistic sport. When he'd finished with them, he would throttle those who had not entered willingly into the nasty games he devised to satisfy his perverted desires. He used two ligatures, a rosary, and a tourniquet he'd made out of a board and ropes. He disposed of his victims by burying them in the crawl space. But so insatiable was his appetite that the space was all used up by the time of body number 27. Actually, Gacy had lost count. 28 bodies were found under his floor. So he used the garden for the next three. When that was full, he decided to use the Des Plaines River as a dumping ground. 5 bodies ended up there, among them Robert Peast's. That was the sinister secret Gacy had been so keen to keep that he'd given his police tail the slip. With Des Plaines police clearly not intending to pussyfoot with him over the lad's disappearance, drastic action was needed. John Gacy had, by his own confused confession, killed 36 people in 6 years. Yet the press, police, and people of Chicago had no idea there was a serial killer in their midst, let alone the worst ever encountered in America to that date. Cook County Medical Examiner Dr. Robert Stein, in charge of the dreadful job of assembling whole cadavers from the rotted and mummified remains in the house, was overwhelmed by the task ahead of him. "It's frightening," he said. "That's the only word I can use. Frightening." Gacy tried to kill himself while he was in custody. He had to be restrained and watched continuously. While he was being questioned, the Illinois authorities contacted police in Texas, where Dean Call and Elmer Wayne Henley had similarly entrapped, tortured, and murdered adolescent boys in a boathouse. The way the victims had been abused and buried seemed so similar the Des Plaines police wondered whether Gacy, like Call, might have had an accomplice. But it seemed that Gacy had worked on his own. In April 1979, Gacy's house was demolished as unsafe. The police had excavated in and around it to such an extent that the decision was probably sound. But the neighbours wanted it down because morbid sightseers were gathering all the time. Pre-trial hearings held before Judge John White led to Gacy's being debarred from attending them for his own safety. The parents of victims were only the spearhead of those who might have wanted to take the law into their own hands. There was little point in trying to deny the murders. Defence lawyer Sam Amirante pleaded Gacy not guilty by reason of insanity. He stressed the difference between his political life and his private life. He said he was a real-life Jekyll and Hyde figure. 4 psychiatrists testified that Gacy was one of the most complex characters they'd ever met. But the prosecution put all this down to a bamboozling act, and the jury agreed. John Wayne Gacy was found guilty on all counts and sentenced to die in an electric chair. At that date, Illinois had not judicially executed anybody for over 10 years. It was thought he would never die in the electric chair. It was wrong. John Wayne Gacy was ultimately executed.